Beginning of 2016, I wanted to better design my car for more forward drive. With more wingless racing becoming prevalent in Pennsylvania and across the United States, we need to try to get more drive out of the car. The biggest way and easiest way to get more drive is to get more weight on the rear wheels. And one of the most effective ways to get static rear weight on the wheels is to move the rear axle forward. So the X7 was the concept of moving the axle forward. So we decided to build the X7 to allow you to either run it in the axle forward or the standard axle position, the X6 axle position, which is also the same as the X4. Austin, on his new car, is running the axle forward. He's doing a lot of wingless racing. So he has two sets of tabs in here for his Jacob's ladder. Set there and a set down there. It's actually underneath the axle there. You can see the tabs up here. Two sets of tabs. To run the axle forward, we have to put the Jacob's ladder or the Panhard bar behind the rear axle. This allows us to get the axle front without the Jacob's ladder or the Panhard bar getting into the seat. Because if we have to move the axle forward and then we move the seat forward with it, we're not really gaining as much rear weight bias as we possibly could. Some other things that we incorporated in with the X7 are, and this is after a whole lot of R&D and getting the axle forward position to work with the wing on and wing off. With all the extra rear weight, we needed more ways to control all that weight transfer. So we redesigned our rear torsion arms to have two mounts for the shock. And also to be able to run the longer shackles, we put this little torsion shock standoff on the torsion arm. And you can flip this little triangle around to move your shock front or back, which changes the effective shock rate. So it essentially makes the car think it has a stiffer shock on it. So with the X7, the extra rear weight, moving that shock forward helps to control that extra weight transfer. We also went with adjustable front shock sliders that, with everybody running different shock manufacturers now, Austin's running the FK shocks on this car. Of course, a lot of people running the ARS shocks and AFCO, CSI, maybe a few pro shocks. They're all different lengths. And with our old car, we had a fixed shock height. This new car has sliding adjustable shocks, so you can run different shock heights without having the shock bottom or top out. Not really a performance advantage, unless you look at the fact that some guys were not getting proper shock travel out of their shocks, then this definitely will help those guys. Of course, with better performance, you have to have a better look. So we had all new arm guards made up. This is a two-piece right side panel. And again, going with the whole wingless idea, we want to increase our yaw resistance. And to do that, we put little kickouts on the panels. We add the wingless panel up here, wingless panel down here with the kickout. Put a little kickout down here. All kinds of little extra things to help increase the yaw resistance of the car. We also redesigned the right front panel with a little kick out in here to help keep dirt out of the adjustable pedal assembly. Every once in a while we get a rock in there, might cause the pedals not to work right. So that little extra panel in there helps keep the dirt out. We also have a left side wingless panel, a new arm guard here too. We also have the option of running a wingless panel down on the left side as well, although Austin didn't put that on his car. It does make it a little harder to work on, but it helps for the look too. There's also a new left side front arm guard. Do you have that?
Yeah, that's there.
So we got the Austin Quick left side arm guard that when he's ready to go to the track, we'll put that on there. Of course, adds to the look. The coolness factor, if you will, of the X7 chassis.
Yeah,
we didn't change anything really from the X6. We just gave you extra options. we changed the look, we changed the shock towers, but you can still have all the pickup points be the exact same as the X6. The X7 just gives you a lot of extra options. It's configurable, as I like to say, because racing is not the same from track to track, from person to person, conditions change. So the car has to be adaptable. That's what we did with the X7. Chris Snyder and his new X7, he's running winged at Lanco. He's got his axle in the forward position as well. Jim Radney, of course, he's having great success this year. Just won at Kutztown last week. He's running the axle in the standard position. So it's fun to see what different guys do with the setups, see what works, see what they like. We don't try to dictate what people do or how they race. We just try to give them options and help them step through and provide them with what they're comfortable with. So I'm really excited for this year. I'm excited to see Austin race this car, to get out, get some good laps in, have a great time racing, get out and support our customers. That's, as an employee, Austin, it's great for me to have him out at the track to support our customers at the track. And he loves to go out and race, and he loves the customer support as well. So I'm really excited to see him go out, have his own car, have him go out and be competitive, learn about the cars to be able to better help customers on the phone too. He answers the phone a lot here at Hyper. And also to see all our customers out there racing on their new cars. See what setups they end up with. Everybody ends up a little bit different. Some like to share information, some like to keep it a secret. So, but that's what makes racing great. It's an individual sport. It's a team sport, you know, in the pit crews and the chiefs and the racers and the drivers. But then each team is different. They all have their different things they do, different adjustments they make. We're here to guide you. We're here to give you support, try to help you figure your car out. A lot of people are happy right out of the box with our setups that we offer online. I redid the whole setup sheet this year. It's like 10 pages long now, because dirt track racing is not simple. As much as you want to try to narrow it down, is make this adjustment for this situation, that adjustment for that situation, it's rarely that simple. So in our new setup guide, we try to walk you through all the different adjustments, when to adjust them, why to adjust them, try to educate you, bring you truth from Hyper Racing.
That is the goal. So you see it now done, and we'll kind of rewind and spin to the first scene, which is getting the material. Fresh batch today. That's how a car is started. The first step, getting the material. Got it. Does it say where it's from? It usually comes from Germany or Plymouth, right?
Yeah, usually Germany.
Only the best.
Bentler.
Nice.
Not Chinese material.
No Chinese.
No Chinese. We don't deal with that.
So step one here of welding a frame. It's on the table.
Yeah.
And the halves are done.
Halves are done. Drilled.
Bent. Notched.
Notched.
And you welded them together on the old jig table.
Yep.
And then he gets all the crossbars, pretty much all the pieces to hold it together, right?
Every single tube gets put in here, Smith bar, halos, everything. And then once we come off the table, that's when we put your wing sockets and your Zeus tabs on, and then we're going to put on the rotisserie and weld it complete.
There we go. And so that'll do it for the table section.
Yeah, that's pretty much it.
And we'll see you on the rotisserie. Complete?
8.5 hours later, she's done. Yeah.
Finish complete.
Now you gotta go over to Chris and get a body.
To the body. Next process, it's with Chris Snyder, the body. So Snyder will start with the dash, belly pans, ignition panel, hood, arm guards, then all the lower sheet metal.
I lay one piece at a time. I start with the front belly pan, then I go to the radiator shroud, the ignition panel, the back belly pan, the firewall. Then I go to the fiberglass dash, the arm guards, then I go to the hood, and then I fit all the lower sheet metal in that order on every car for the last 12,000 cars.
Last, what, 25 years, right?
22.
Chris is the first employee, and still here. Rocking it out.
That's how you do a body.
Next step is powder coat, correct?
Yep.
Cool.
Then assembly.
Give me a little, come and hit the mic. Close it. No, close the, hit the screen, the lens. What do you got for me, bud?
Hold up. Don't be filming nothing just yet.
No, is it not back?
Huh? Whose tank is this?
That's mine.
That's what I thought.
Look at that beauty.
Yeah, well, I wouldn't have put it on the blanket. You know, only the best for you. Them things are hot out of the oven. That took me a little longer.
Hot?
They were, and they're not now.
Okay.
I kind of don't really trust hauling them when they're warm. I think they might scratch till I get down to room temp. I don't know that, but...
Okay, 30 minutes, boom. That's what it takes to put a body on a 600 Hyper. It's pretty good actually, 30 minutes. When you got everything laid out, so when you got everything done just to put the body on, no springs, nothing like that, it was 30 minutes to put the body on. So yeah, looking good, looking pretty good. I like it, got the left side
pretty much all the standard panels now. Pretty sexy. So one of the steps, important process, is Bill Simcoe. He does all the intricate parts, axles, earth bars, all the important stuff you see. What, 40 more times?
What?
40 more times.
At least.
Boom to boom to powder. Human emotion. They only see everybody only gets to see your marketing side.
Yeah, I know, and I'm all polished and professional. But in reality,
and then she comes in and she does the pedal assemblies and she just lets it out on the pedal assemblies.
It just comes out, and it's because this is a tricky little job, but I figure if I can learn how to do this, anyone can. It just takes patience.
It's a very nice piece though that Mike did.
It actually goes together really well once you do it about a few times. And probably people who know what they're doing can actually, like, whip this out.
You know what you're doing when you do it. She's very modest.
Okay, now this is where I usually like to put a little piece of something in. Back it off a little bit.
Nice.
And then test it when I'm all done.
Do you make car sounds?
No. No, I should though. I could add that to my test procedure.
Like, what? How did this idea come about? Like, do you remember it? Did you have it like you were at dinner and was like, oh my god?
Yeah, I'd never know when he gets these ideas, but all of a sudden one day he's like, hey, I'm gonna just design this crazy, super complicated pedal assembly. And that way it's adjustable.
Which is very revolutionary.
Yes. But yes,
the industry is slowly catching up on this deal.
But we have the original.
Hang on. So, Christy, you want to tell everybody what you're going to do here?
So, I'm going to put a pedal assembly together.
Nice.
Get everything ready.
From start to finish.
Have a bolt kit right here. Tools. Two pedals are already assembled. You can adjust these wherever you want them. All right, you ready?
Perfect.
Here we go, Austin. I think I got everything actually. Done. Wait till you see this little bonus feature on there.
One of the next steps in the process is the air box for the fuel injection, and Logan Spar is putting together mine right now. So what do we got here, bud?
Well, now it's in all the pieces and needs to put into one big piece.
One big piece.
Like a puzzle.
Okay, so which piece you got there?
Well, this is the bottom piece that goes onto the throttle bodies.
Okay.
And stacks go in there.
Stacks. What is that? That's adjustable velocity stacks, right?
Yep. HBS plate on there.
Build an air box by Logan Spar. Are you proud of that?
Yeah.
Thumbs up. Rebuild, and we deal with try to deal with all the shock manufacturers, but the main ones we carry: Factory Kane, ARS, AFCO, and NCSI. So I'll show you. I'm going to refurbish some FKs, and I'm going to start off with those. So yeah, it's a pretty cool process. Really cool, actually. See the inside of a shock and its workings. It's cool. So yeah, spin to the next scene.
Ready to start? Click on the banner to take your fit test or visit lumosity.com.
Monsters. Call the tape on it. No tape. Yeah. So you take all the pieces out you don't need, right?
Take everything out you don't need. Then tell it what it wants to see after that.
Because we only use, what, the injector, the crank, the cam.
Coils.
Coils.
Charging system.
Charging system.
Or
tack lead, correct?
Yeah.
How many harnesses do you think you do a year?
Well, I don't know, I'd say probably in the, maybe 250? 200? Could it be that much?
Feels like the
thank you for watching. That is what 6 weeks looks like in 30 minutes of a car build process. We kind of got it down to a science, which is good. We can provide good turnaround for you, the customer. I just want to say one thing before we sign off here at Hyper. We want to give a huge shout out to all the vendors and our customers. One for the vendors, because it's not only us that got to put in the effort and materialize everything, but it is also possible with them because in their teams. So appreciate it to all the vendors that we get to deal with. and then the customer, you at the end of the day, making it all possible for us to have an industry for it. So thanks to everybody involved. We at Hyper are very blessed and grateful to be a part of it. And thank you for watching. Make sure to like and subscribe to our channel by clicking on the link over here in the lower right hand of your screen. And we'll see you at the racetrack. Make sure to comment and share. Other than that, thank you and adios.